Sisters, cover your heads. Brothers, uncover your heads. We're going to stand and face Jerusalem and open up. Our Father, which art in heaven.
Our Father, which art in heaven.
Hallowed be thy name.
Hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done in earth.
Thy will be done in earth.
As it is in heaven.
As it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our debts.
And forgive us our debts.
As we forgive our debtors.
As we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation.
And lead us not into temptation.
But deliver us from evil.
But deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom.
For thine is the kingdom.
And the power.
And the power.
And the glory.
And the glory.
Forever.
Forever.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
For he is good.
For he is good.
For his mercy endureth forever.
For his mercy endureth forever.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
For he is good.
For he is good.
For his mercy endureth forever.
For his mercy endureth forever.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Today's scripture reading comes from Hebrews chapter 9, verses 1 through 5. Then verily, the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service and a worldly sanctuary, for there was a tabernacle made. The first, wherein was the candlestick and the table and the showbread, which is called the sanctuary. And after the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all, which had the golden censer and the ark of the covenant overlaid round about with gold, wherein was the golden pot that had manna, and Aaron's rod that budded, and the tables of the covenant, and over it the cherubims of glory, shadowing the mercy seat, of which we cannot now speak particularly. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Praise to the Most High God, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Peace to everyone that's here today in the name of Jesus. Peace to everyone that's watching us live on the internet. And as always, it's good to stand before you on the Lord's high Sabbath day. And today we're going to deal with the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which is the day that follows the Passover. And it's one of the Lord's high days, and he has commanded us to keep this day. And I always say, if you call yourself a Christian, then you will be observing this day as well. And we kicked it off with the Passover, to where you ate the bread or the body of Jesus and drank his blood or his wine. And that signified you putting yourself under his blood. And now the feast that follows that is you're supposed to eat unleavened bread. Not only physical bread that is unleavened, but also the spiritual unleavened bread of God, because he is that bread of life, and we're going to show you that. And you must eat his words. That's why doing this on this lesson handout, take it home with you, because this feast lasts for 7 days, and we have daily readings for each day of this feast that you should be able to, that you should read every day of the feast, because it lasts for 7 days. So we're supposed to not only eat physical unleavened bread for 7 days, but we're supposed to read this book also. So let's get right into the lesson. We're going to start it off like we always do in Leviticus chapter 23. And I always like to say, if you understand the 23rd chapter of Leviticus, then you will understand the Lord's plan to salvage mankind. But if they keep you out of this Old Testament, then you don't have any understanding of what the Lord has in store for his creation. So let's start this in Leviticus 23. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Leviticus 23 and verse 1. Okay, read.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, concerning the feast of the Lord.
So we always have to point this out once again, that these are the feasts of the Lord. Not the feast of the Jews, but the feast of the Lord. Go ahead.
Which ye shall proclaim to be holy convocations, even these are my feasts.
And they're holy convocations, are holy gatherings. That's why we're here today, to have a holy convocation concerning the Lord's feast. Go ahead.
6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of rest and holy convocation. You shall do no work therein. It is the Sabbath of the Lord in all your dwellings.
So once again, right at the top of the list is the Lord's weekly Sabbath. 6 days shall work be done. It's also a Sabbath of rest, the holy convocation. Don't do any work. It is the Sabbath, the Sabbath of the Lord in all your dwellings. So this is the Lord's Sabbath. Go ahead.
These are the feasts of the Lord, even holy convocations, which ye shall proclaim in their seasons. In the 14th day of the first month at even is the Lord's Passover.
Which we observed yesterday, the 14th day of the first month at even, is the Lord's Passover. Go ahead.
And on the 15th day of the same month is the feast of unleavened bread unto the Lord. 7 days you must eat unleavened bread.
So the 15th day, which is the day after the Passover, is what? The feast of unleavened bread unto the Lord. And this is the day that messed the whole world up. That's why you got Good Friday, because of this day right here. Because they read in the 19th chapter of John that the next day was a Sabbath day. And the day before that, Jesus was crucified. So they understood that the Sabbath day was the seventh day of the week. So he must have died on a Friday. But they didn't understand that this was the Lord has 7 annual Sabbath days. And this happened to be one of them, the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So on the 15th day of the same month is the Feast of Unleavened Bread unto the Lord. 7 days you must eat unleavened bread. And that has a big meaning. It's more than just eating this flat bread and dry crackers, whatever it is. It's bitter, but it has a bigger meaning. It's unleavened. Anything that has leaven in it, spiritual leaven, is sin. We're going to show you that. That's why you must eat unleavened bread for 7 days, because you've already been put under the blood because you took the Passover. Now you got to walk this straight and narrow. You got to not sin for 7 days spiritually, which means you must walk this straight and narrow till you die. So you must continue to eat that unleavened bread of life spiritually. But for now, we're going to do this for 7 days, but it has a bigger meaning. Go ahead.
7. In the first day, you shall have an holy convocation. You shall do no servile work therein.
So the first day, we're going to have a holy gathering. So this is an annual Sabbath. It's a high Sabbath. You shall do no servile work therein. Go ahead.
But ye shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord 7 days. In the seventh day is an holy convocation. You shall do no servile work therein.
So this feast lasts 7 days. The first day is a holy convocation. And the seventh day, which we're going to be observing next Tuesday, after the same manner, is also a holy convocation. You shall do no servile work therein. So you're not supposed to be working on this day if it's within your means. You're not supposed to be at work. You're supposed to be observing this day, because this is the Lord's high Sabbath day, and he commanded us to keep it. No servile work therein. Of course, you can work whatever pertains to bring the feast together. You can work. You can cook on this day. We're going to show you can drink on this day. But let's keep moving, because we got to get to these scriptures, get to this spiritual food. We're going to feed your mind first. And then we're going to feed your belly. Exodus 12. But it all starts with the Passover. That's the beginning of it. That's why you have to understand what the Passover means in order to understand the rest of the Lord's feast days. Because you have to start somewhere. So let's go back to the beginning when he instituted the Passover. And let's see what he told them right after you put yourself under that blood, how you're supposed to conduct yourself. Exodus 12, and pick it up at verse 1. Okay, read.
And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man, according to his eating, shall make your count for the lamb.
So now we have to reiterate this, because the Feast of Unleavened Bread is actually a continuation of the Passover. That's why we're going to read this, and we're going to read more into this. Of course, we dealt with the Passover, but now we're dealing with part two. In other words, go ahead.
Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. Ye shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats, and ye shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door post of the houses, wherein they shall eat it. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw, nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire, his head with his legs, and with the pertinence thereof. And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire.
So you're supposed to eat all of this lamb, and if anything remains, you burn it with fire. Go ahead.
And thus shall you eat it, with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And ye shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt.
So the Lord said, I'm going to pass through and I'm going to kill everybody that's not under the blood. So now if you happen to believe what Moses said, then you're going to do to follow the instructions. You're going to put some blood over the doorpost and the upper doorpost. And when the Lord come through killing, when he see the blood, he's going to pass over you. In other words, you won't get killed. So now, since you made it through the Passover by following the instructions, now you must continue to follow the instructions in order for the Lord to continue to pass over you. Because as long as you're under that blood, you're going to do the instructions. That's going to keep you under the blood. But the minute you fall by the wayside or go down a different path, the blood is gone. Keep reading.
14. And this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and you shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever. 7 days shall you eat unleavened bread. Even the first day you shall put away leaven out of your house.
So 7 days, right after this memorial to Passover, he went right into the Feast of Unleavened Bread. It says 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. Even the first day you got to put leaven out of your houses. That's why we get rid of all the bread byproducts that make cookies and cakes. Anything with leaven in it that's rising, it's got to go. You put it out your house, you get rid of it. We try to, because we have some understanding, these days come up, holidays come up every year, you try to buy enough to where you don't have to throw it all away. Because it's hard, as broke as we are, food is expensive, especially a loaf of bread. So you try to buy some bread at least a week before this, so now that dwindled down, so you don't have that much to throw away.
Yeah.
That's some understanding. So put the leaven out your house. Go ahead.
For whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel.
So you can't eat any bread during this 7 day period, or that soul will be cut off. And when the Lord say cut off, that means he's going to kill you. And that's how serious this high day is. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread from the first and the seventh. Go ahead.
And in the first day there shall be an holy convocation. And in the seventh day, there shall be an holy convocation to you. No manner of work shall be done in them, save that which every man must eat, that only may be done of you.
So you see, the Lord is instituting this in Egypt before they even got out. He's letting them know what I want you to do with the instructions I want you to observe when you get into the land. He said on the first day, you're going to have a holy convocation. And the seventh day is going to be a holy convocation. No manner of work shall be done in them, save that which every man must eat, that only may be done of you. So on the high Sabbath days, we can cook on this day. You can have a little wine on this day too. But on the weekly Sabbath, you can't. But when the high Sabbath falls on the weekly Sabbath, the high Sabbath supersedes that. Somebody needs to take care of that noise back there right now. Keep reading.
17. And ye shall observe the feast of unleavened bread. For in this self same day have I brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore shall you observe this day in your generations by an ordinance forever.
So we see this day has another significance, that this is the day that Israel was free from bondage after 400 years of slavery. The Lord freed them. That's why we observe this day. It has a bigger understanding and a bigger meaning other than just coming together, eating and drinking, and having a good time. We understand what this means. Go ahead.
In the first month, on the 14th day of the month at even, ye shall eat unleavened bread until the 1 20th day of the month at even. 7 days shall there be no leaven found in your houses. For whosoever eateth that which is leavened, even that soul shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he be a stranger or born in the land.
So we see this goes for everybody. Matter of fact, the whole world should be observing this day. The whole world, and they will when Jesus comes back. Everybody should be observing this day. Shall no leaven be found in your houses. That's why we get rid of the stuff. Israel or the stranger of the born in the land. 20, what does it say?
Ye shall eat nothing leavened. In all your habitations shall you eat unleavened bread.
So he said you shall eat nothing leavened. And that's the physical part of it. But what does he mean, eat nothing leavened? You can eat some bad doctrine. That's leavening too. Because that will mess you up. Skip down to verse 29 and read it.
And it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle.
So the Lord kept his promise. He told Israel, I'm going to come through here, and I'm going to kill everybody. If I see the blood, I'm going to pass over you. So the Lord was right on time. He came at midnight and smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt. Why did these people in Egypt die? They was not under the blood. They didn't listen. After all 9 of those plagues, somebody should have, you know, a red flag should have came up. But nobody listened. Go ahead.
And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians. And there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. And he called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, rise up and get you forth from among my people, both ye and the children of Israel, and go serve the Lord as you have said. Also take your flocks and your herds as ye have said, and be gone, and bless me also.
So now that got Pharaoh's attention, right there on the spot. You know, he was playing with the Lord. He thought he was, you know, playing with Moses, but he was actually playing with God. He put a plague on him. Then he changed his mind. He said, okay, y'all can go. Please, if you take this plague off of me, I'm going to let y'all go. The Lord took the plague off. He said, changed his mind. But this right here, the death of the firstborn, that got his attention. He told Moses, he called for him by night, and said, rise up, get ye forth from among my people, both you and the children of Israel, and go. Serve the Lord as you have said. Take your flocks, your herds, and be gone. And while you're going out the door, give me a blessing too. Go ahead.
And the Egyptians were urging upon the people that they might send them out of the land in haste. For they said, we be all dead men.
So they was urging. They wanted these people out of here quick. Because as long as Israel was around, bad things was happening to Egypt. Like that, who's that guy, Bad Luck Slept Rock? Nobody wanted that dude around. Because soon as he showed up, what happened? Bad things. So they was urgent to get the people out. Go ahead.
And the people took their dough before it was leavened, their kneading troughs being bound up in their clothes upon their shoulders. And the children of Israel did according to the word of Moses. And they borrowed of the Egyptians jewels of silver and jewels of gold and raiment. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, so that they lent unto them such things as they required, and they spoiled the Egyptians.
So the people took their dough before it was what? Leavened, before it had time to rise, because it was urgent that they got them out. It had the agent in there. They just didn't have time to wait around for it to rise up. But it was in there, because it says it took their dough before it was leavened, their kneading troughs being bound upon their shoulders, and they got up out of there. Verse 37, read it.
And the children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth, about 600,000 on foot that were men beside children. And a mixed multitude went up also with them, and flocks and herds, even very much cattle. And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough which they brought forth out of Egypt, for it was not leavened.
So they baked what? Unleavened cakes with the dough that they brought out of Egypt. Why was it unleavened? Because it didn't have time to rise up. But the leavening agent was in there, just didn't have time to rise. But they baked it before it had time to rise. Go ahead.
Because they were thrust out of Egypt and could not tarry, neither had they prepared for themselves any victual.
That's like when you make bread, right? All the old people that's in here, y'all made bread, right? Some young people too, I don't know. You got to wait for the bread to rise up, and you got to knead it again. And you put it off somewhere, let it rise, knead it again. But they didn't have time to do this because they got thrust out. Where we at?
40.
Read it.
Now the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt was 430 years.
So they dwelt there 430 years. Keep reading.
And it came to pass at the end of the 430 years, even the selfsame day it came to pass, that all the host of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt.
And what day was that? The Feast of Unleavened Bread. Go ahead.
It is a night to be much observed unto the Lord for bringing them out from the land of Egypt. This is that night of the Lord to be observed of all the children of Israel in their generations.
So everybody's supposed to observe this night. This is a night much to be observed. This is a great occasion right here. And when the Lord comes back to deliver his people, it's going to be on a grander scale, bigger than this. Because they just came out of Egypt. The Lord is going to deliver his people when he come back from every nation all around the world. That's going to be a mass exodus. That's going to be a sight to see if you happen to be part of it. But let's go to Exodus 13 and pick it up at verse 3. Exodus 13 and 3, read.
And Moses said unto the people, remember this day in which you came out from Egypt, out of the house of bondage. For by strength of hand, the Lord brought you out from this place. There shall no leavened bread be eaten.
So he always making a point, reiterating, remember this day, there shall no leavened bread be eaten. Go ahead.
This day came you out in the month of Abib. And it shall be when the Lord shall bring thee into the land of the Canaanites.
That's good. Skip down to verse 8.
And thou shalt show.
No, I'm sorry. Keep reading. My bad. Keep reading.
Verse 5. And it shall be when the Lord shall bring thee into the land of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, which he sware unto thy fathers to give thee, a land flowing with milk and honey, that thou shalt keep this service in this month.
So he telling them, look, I'm going to take you into paradise. Because that's what that land flowing milk and honey is. That's paradise. And he had his people. He put them under. They went under the blood. Then he told them to eat unleavened bread for 7 days. Keep eating that word. Keep eating that word so you can get to paradise. Go ahead.
7 days thou shalt eat unleavened bread. And in the seventh day shall be a feast to the Lord. Unleavened bread shall be eaten 7 days, and there shall no leavened bread be seen with thee, neither shall there be any leaven seen with thee in all thy quarters.
So you got to get rid of it. Throw it away. Don't try to save it. It's got to go. If it's in your house, it's got to go. Go ahead.
And thou shalt show thy son in that day, saying, this is done because of that which the Lord did unto me when I came forth out of Egypt. And it shall be for a sign unto thee upon thine hand, and for a memorial between thine eyes, that the Lord's law may be in thy mouth. For with a strong hand hath the Lord brought thee out of Egypt. Thou shalt therefore keep this ordinance in his season from year to year.
And you're going to show your son in that day saying, this is done. Why? Why are we eating this unleavened bread for 7 days, mama? Daddy? You're going to be able to tell him. Why are we getting all the bread and the cookies? Why can't I have some Oreo cookies today? If y'all eat Oreo cookies. And you're going to be able to tell them. This is the day that the Lord, which the Lord did unto me when I came out of Egypt. This is why we're doing this, son or daughter. And this is a sign. It's a memorial. This is why we're doing this. This is why this comes up once a year, to remind us of the things that the Lord did for us in the past and what he's going to do for us in the future. We finished that?
Yeah, skip to
17 and read it.
And it came to pass, when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God led them not through the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest peradventure the people repent when they see war, and they return to Egypt.
So now they done got, they out of Egypt. They headed towards the promised land now, right? So now Pharaoh, it came to pass, when Pharaoh let the people go, God didn't lead them through the way of the Philistines, because he know his people. They chicken. You are what you eat, right? That's why we like chicken. Because if they saw the Philistines, what's going to happen? Oh, they're going to get scared and run right back to Egypt. Because going through the land of Philistines, that was a shortcut. Boom, they could have went right into the land. Mm-hmm. But he's like, no, if they see these cats, they're going to turn yellow. But verse 18, read it.
But God led the people about through the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea. And the children of Israel went up harnessed out of the land of Egypt. And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him, for he had straitly sworn the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and ye shall carry up my bones away hence with you. And they took their journey from Succoth and encamped in Etham in the edge of the wilderness. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, to go by day and night. He took not away the pillar of the cloud by day, nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people.
So once the people was under the blood, they was under that covenant of Jesus now. So who's leading them? The Lord is leading them. All they have to do is follow the instructions. He says he was in a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by the day. He was leading the people into where? Into the promised land, into paradise. Let's go right into Exodus 14, because Pharaoh got mad. He came to his senses. He let go all his free labor. Go ahead, 14 and 1, read it.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, that they turn and encamp before Pahai-Hiaroth, between Migdol and the sea, over against Baal-Zephon, before it shall ye encamp by the sea. For Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they are entangled in the land. The wilderness hath shut them in. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, that he shall follow after them. And I will be honored upon Pharaoh and upon all his host, that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord. And they did so.
So now Moses, the Lord is telling Moses exactly how the script going down. He said, look, the people going to tell Pharaoh, look, these people is gone, but I'm a hard. They're going to come after you, but I'm a harden Pharaoh's heart. Verse 5, go ahead. Skip down to 8. Yeah, skip down to 8. I'm sorry.
And the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And he pursued after the children of Israel. And the children of Israel went out with an high hand. But the Egyptians pursued after them, all the horses and chariots of Pharaoh, and his horsemen, and his army, and overtook them encamping by the sea beside Pi-Hiah-Hareth, before Baal-Zephon. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes. And behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord.
So everything is going the way the Lord had it planned. He told Moses, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to harden his heart, and he's going to come after you. Because I'm not finished with this dude. I still got to whip his head one more time. Go ahead.
And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us, to carry us forth out of Egypt?
Boy, Israel will be coming up with something, don't they? I would have never thought of that, because there wasn't no graves. We're going to be buried out here in the desert. Go ahead, verse 12.
Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness.
Man. 13, read.
And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom you have seen today, you shall see them again no more forever.
So you know the Lord had to be, he had to do something, because they complained right there on the spot. But the Lord still had to show them who was in charge. I'm the one that freed you. I'm going to take care of these Egyptians, because you ain't going to see them no more forever. Go ahead.
The Lord shall fight for you, and he shall hold your peace.
So the Lord is going to fight for you, so shut up. Pretty much. Hold your peace, right? That means shut up in a good way. Go ahead.
And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel, that they go forward. But lift thou up thy rod, and stretch out thine hand over the sea, and divide it. and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. And I, behold, I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, and they shall follow them. And I will get me honor upon Pharaoh, and upon all his host, upon his chariots, and upon his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I have gotten me honor upon Pharaoh, upon his chariots, and upon his horsemen. And the angel of God, which went before the camp of Israel, removed and went behind them. And the pillar of the cloud went from before their face and stood behind them. And it came between the camp of the Egyptians and the camp of Israel. And it was a cloud and darkness to them, but it gave light by night to these, so that one came not near the other all the night.
So you see what the Lord is doing. The angel went behind the camp and stood between the Egyptians and Israel. It was night to them, but it was daylight to Israel, because the Lord had to took them all night to split that sea. Because the Lord created all the elements on this earth. He created the wind too. I mean, I'm quite sure he could have just snapped his finger and the sea would have split. But nah, he's going to use the elements. He took them an east wind, and it took them all night to separate that sea. Go ahead.
And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night, and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea upon the dry ground, and the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand and on their left. And the Egyptians pursued and went in after them to the midst of the sea, even all the Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen.
So now you know they had to be had some hard hearts, hardened hearts, I should say, or hard-headed, to go into the sea after some people. This is the Lord orchestrating this. So they pursued them. They went right in after them. Go ahead.
And it came to pass that in the morning watch, the Lord looked unto the host of the Egyptians through the pillar of fire and of the cloud, and troubled the host of the Egyptians, and took off their chariot wheels, that they drave them heavily, so that the Egyptians said, let us flee from the face of Israel, for the Lord fighteth for them against the Egyptians.
So now the Lord did something practical to slow them down, right? Just gave them some flat tires. Broke off their wheels, and now all of a sudden, somebody wised up and said, hold on, the Lord is fighting for these people. How all of a sudden our wheels going to start breaking off now? We got to go, but it's too late, because sometime when you're at that point of no return, there's no coming back, especially if you reprobate. Go ahead.
And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thine hand over the sea, that the waters may come again upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots, and upon their horsemen. And Moses stretched forth his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to his strength when the morning appeared. And the Egyptians fled against it, and the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. And the waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen and all the host of Pharaoh that came into the sea after them. There remained not so much as one of them. But the children of Israel walked upon dry land in the midst of the sea, and the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand and on the left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore. And Israel saw that great work which the Lord did upon the Egyptians. And the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses.
So the Lord saved Israel. That day, what day was that? When they came out of Egypt, the Feast of Unleavened Bread. That's what that day represents. The release from captivity. And he killed all the Egyptians. It ain't like the movie where Yul Brynner saw his army get drowned. Pharaoh was in there too, according to what we read. Killed them all. And Israel was happy. But he said he was, the Lord said, the book said he was a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud in the daytime. Let's go see who that is. Go to 1 Corinthians 10 to show you who exactly who that was in that pillar of fire and that cloud. Because most people think the Old Testament is all about the Father. Uh-uh. We're going to show you who was in that cloud. And if you know who was in that cloud, you know who was bringing them plagues on Egypt. You know who killed the firstborn. That's why we deal with this Jesus of the Bible, not the powder puff Jesus that we've been accustomed to growing up with. The Jesus of this Bible is serious. He will kill you. He even told the people, don't fear the man that can kill the body. Fear him that after he has killed, can wake you up and throw you in the lake of fire. Who was he talking about? Himself. 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 1, read it.
Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea.
Didn't we read that? We just read it in Exodus, right? I should not you be ignorant that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea. Go ahead.
And were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ.
So that was Jesus back then, in that pillar of fire and in that cloud. So if that was Jesus back then in the fire and the cloud, that was Jesus that told them to keep the Passover. That was Jesus that gave them unleavened bread. That was Jesus that gave them Pentecost, trumpets, all the high days which we observe. And that was Jesus that came down on the mountain and spoke the Ten Commandments in person. So now, how is it that when we get to the New Testament, we can say the Sabbath day is no more? We don't have to keep the feast days no more. I want to know when Jesus said that. If he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, and we can read what he said, keep this, I want to read where he said you don't have to keep it. Show me that in the Bible. I don't want no obscure scripture. I want it right in red where he said, you don't have to keep these days. And when you show me that, I will be the first one to put a tree in my house and go get me some sausage pizza and go to Red Lobster and order that Admiral's platter. But if you can't, then I got to keep eating this unleavened bread of life. Go to Exodus 34. I don't want no hearsay. I want to see it right in the book. All of, everybody say, well, they changed it. They changed. Who is they that changed it? They is a what? A pronoun, right?
Mm-hmm. Sure is.
Put a name on they. Give me a proper noun. And then read it to me. Don't tell me they changed it. Read it to me. Exodus 34 and verse 12. Exodus 34 and 12, read it.
Take heed to thyself, lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land whither thou goest, lest it be for a snare in the midst of thee. But ye shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves. For thou shalt worship no other god. For the Lord, whose name is Jealous, is a jealous God.
So the Lord got another name too. It's called Jealous. And what is jealousy? That's a foul spirit. That's an evil spirit. And it comes upon a man. It might come upon a woman too. But when the Lord is jealous, there's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. You're going to die. Because you are worshiping false gods. He says, for thou shalt worship no other gods. For the Lord whose name is Jealous is a jealous God. So when you eat that leaven, which is false doctrine, in all its forms, you're going to get yourself in trouble with God. Verse 15, go ahead.
Lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land, and they go a-whoring after their gods, and do sacrifice unto their gods. And one call thee, and thou eat of his sacrifice. And thou take of their daughters unto thy sons, and their daughters go a-whoring after their gods, and make thy sons go a-whoring after their gods. Thou shalt make thee no molten gods. The feast of unleavened bread shalt thou keep. 7 days thou shalt eat unleavened bread, as I commanded thee, in the time of the month of Abib. For in the month of Abib thou camest out from Egypt.
So after he instructed you not to be making no false gods and worshiping these gods and dealing with the people, giving your sons and your daughters to them for marriage, he told you, keep the feast of unleavened bread. Eat this unleavened bread for 7 days. Eat it. Let's go to Exodus 31. There's a spiritual meaning behind eating this unleavened bread. But in order to understand the spiritual, you have to understand the physical. Exodus 31 and verse 12. Go ahead.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, Verily my Sabbath you shall keep.
So that's plural. Verily my Sabbaths you shall keep. This is not only the weekly Sabbath, but we just read Leviticus chapter 23 that the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the first night and the seventh night is a Sabbath as well. Go ahead.
For it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am the Lord that doth sanctify you. Ye shall keep the Sabbath therefore, for it is holy unto you. Everyone that defileth it shall surely be put to death. For whosoever doeth any work therein, that soul shall be cut off from among his people.
So you see how serious is the Lord about this Sabbath. But people have belittled it. Just because you don't get killed right away, that don't mean he ain't going to get you at the, you know, at the end of the line. Go ahead.
6 days may work be done, but in the seventh is a Sabbath of rest, holy to the Lord.
Holy to who?
The Lord.
So the Sabbath is holy to the Lord. What's wrong with keeping something that's holy to God? But people don't want to do that. They want to do what's coming up here now Sunday? Easter. Rabbits, eggs, baskets, chocolate bunnies. What does that have to do with the resurrection? Nothing. But that's what people caught up in. But then they don't want to call it Easter no more because they done found out that a lot of things about Easter is garbage. So they're going to change it to what? Resurrection Sunday. You wrong then because he didn't rise on Sunday. But go ahead.
Whosoever doeth any work in the Sabbath day, he shall surely be put to death. Wherefore, the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed.
And I heard this false prophet on the radio, they go right to this scripture right here. When people ask them, how can we not keep in the Sabbath? Well, if you look at Exodus 31, it says the Sabbath day is a sign between the Lord and the children of Israel. They keep the Sabbath, but we keep Sunday. Why? Because Paul broke bread on the first day of the week. When I come to you, lay up on the first day of the week in your storehouse. Two scriptures. From who? Paul. Which don't have nothing to do with saying that you don't have to keep the Sabbath no more. But keeping Sunday, there are no restrictions on Sunday. Zero. All you got to do is show up for a couple hours and you have served the Lord on Sunday. You have to have a beginning and an ending for a day. But they've belittled the Sabbath, tell you don't have to keep it, and they've given you Sunday, which you can't read in the book. Keep reading.
And he gave unto Moses, when he had made an end of communing with him upon Mount Sinai, two tables of testimony, tables of stone written with the finger of God.
So after he did that, when he gave him the commandments, he always reminded Moses, remember the Sabbath day now. That was the last thing the Lord told Moses before he gave him them Ten Commandments. That's how important the Sabbath day is to God. So don't let nobody tell you you don't have to keep this day. You run from them because it ain't safe to walk across the street with them if they're telling you that. Let's go to 2 Chronicles. And pick it up at verse 1. So the Lord said, keep these days forever. When you get into the land, you're going to keep them. Keep them in all your dwellings. Just because you're not in the land, that don't exempt you from keeping this day. Because we're going to read wherever Paul was on his journeys, he was still keeping these days. 2 Chronicles 35 and verse 1, read it.
Moreover, Josiah kept the Passover unto the Lord in Jerusalem, and they killed the Passover on the 14th day of the first month.
Now here's Josiah, he was a good king. They kept the Passover unto the Lord in Jerusalem on the 14th day of the first month, like we read in Leviticus 23. Go ahead.
And he set the priests in their charges and encouraged them to the service of the house of the Lord, and said unto the Levites that taught all Israel, which were holy unto the Lord, put the holy ark in the house which Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, did build. It shall not be a burden upon your shoulders. Serve now the Lord your God and his people Israel.
So now he had to tell the Levites, look, go get that ark, man. Put it in the house of the Lord. And I don't want you to do it grudgingly either. Because apparently they had fell off. So you got to light some fire on them. Look, don't let it be a burden unto you. Serve the Lord. Go ahead.
And prepare yourselves by the houses of your fathers, after your courses, according to the writing of David, king of Israel, and according to the writing of Solomon, his son.
Okay, so now they get ready to keep the Passover. Skip down to verse 10 and read it.
So the service was prepared, and the priests stood in their place, and the Levites in their courses, according to the king's commandment. And they killed the Passover, and the priests sprinkled the blood from their hands, and the Levites flayed them. And they removed the burnt offerings that they might give according to the divisions of the families of the people to offer unto the Lord, as it is written in the book of Moses. And so did they with the oxen. And they roasted the Passover with fire according to the ordinance. But the other holy offerings saw they in pots and in cauldrons and in pans, and divided them speedily among all the people. And afterward they made ready for themselves and for the priests, because the priests, the sons of Aaron, were busied in offering of burnt offerings and the fat until night. Therefore, the Levites prepared for themselves and for the priests, the sons of Aaron.
So there's a lot of things going on now. Everybody's participating in this Passover, because this is a great Passover right here. Skip down to verse 16 and read it.
So all the service of the Lord was prepared the same day to keep the Passover and to offer burnt offerings upon the altar of the Lord, according to the commandment of King Josiah. And the children of Israel that were present kept the Passover at that time, and the Feast of Unleavened Bread 7 days.
So they kept the Passover and what else? The Feast of Unleavened Bread 7 days, because they go hand in hand. You can't have one without the other, because the Feast of Unleavened Bread follows the Passover. Go ahead.
And there was no Passover like that kept in Israel from the days of Samuel the prophet. Neither did all the kings of Israel keep such a Passover as Josiah kept, and the priests, and the Levites, and all Judah and Israel that were present, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem.
So you see how when they fall off for a long time from serving the Lord, all of a sudden, something that should have been on a yearly basis, all of a sudden becomes a great big thing. Why? Because they hadn't been doing it. It's been too much idolatry going on to the fact that they lost sight of what they were supposed to do. And all of a sudden, it's a big thing, and it is. It's a beautiful thing to serve the Lord and have some understanding. This is no headache for nobody. We come here, we eat, we drink, we have a good time, we serve the Lord. All these other folly days that's going on, a headache. We've all been with Christmas, right? Mm-hmm. It's a big headache. You broke. People mad at you because you didn't buy them nothing. And then when you give them a gift, you got to give them the gift receipt, because if they don't like it, they can take it back. What kind of love is that? That's a headache. And by the time you get out of debt from Christmas, what rolls up on you? Easter. Well, you get the Easter clothes. They Easter clothes, right? You got your Easter suit. You got your eggs and all this other stuff that has nothing to do with God. But all that's a headache. This is a joyous occasion. And the Lord tells you exactly how to serve him and how to conduct yourselves during his high days. Let's go to Matthew 16. And we're going to start wrapping this up so we can get to this food. So it's always good to understand why you're here today, as opposed to being at work making some money. I'd rather serve the Lord than work on the Sabbath day for $1 million an hour. Guaranteed. It's a no-brainer for me. I don't care how much money you put on the table. I'm not going to take it. Matthew 16 and 1, read.
The Pharisees also with the Sadducees came, and tempting desired him that he would show them a sign from heaven.
So now they always messing with Jesus. All the miracles he done did, they still tempting him. Go ahead.
He answered and said unto them, when it is evening, ye say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. O ye hypocrites, ye can discern the face of the sky, but can ye not discern the signs of the times.
So now these are the big time religious leaders. You say, look, you can see the sky. You can see the signs in the sky, how the weather's going to be. But you can't see the sign of the times. Or what's happening, what's going on, who's in front of you. Look at the works that I'm doing. Go ahead.
A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given unto it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas. And he left them and departed.
And other scriptures tell you, what was that sign? That he was going to be in the grave for what? 3 days and three nights. Mark tells you after 3 days. What's 3 days? 72 hours. 3 days and three nights. 72 hours. That's the sign he was going to give them. But what do they give you now? Good Friday and Easter Sunday. That's a day and a half that he's in the grave. And I got an article in the newspaper that Pope Benedict actually said that. It was a day and a half. But Jesus said 3 days and three nights. So which Jesus you going to believe? The one that was in the grave for 3 days and three nights? Or the one that rose on Easter Sunday? I'm going with the one that's in the book. Because scriptures will tell you that he died in the middle of the week. And that's a Wednesday for those that don't know it. And we can prove that in another lesson. But then that's another lesson. But keep reading.
And when his disciples were come to the other side, they had forgotten to take bread. Then Jesus said unto them, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees.
So he told them, look, when they got to the other side, they forgot to take bread. And Jesus point blank told them, look, take heed. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. What you mean leaven? What is that? Go ahead.
And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have taken no bread. Which when Jesus perceived, he said unto them, O ye of little faith, why reason ye among yourselves, because ye have brought no bread? Do ye not yet understand, neither remember the 5 loaves of the 5,000, and how many baskets ye took up? Neither the 7 loaves of the 4,000, and how many baskets you took up?
So now they reasoned amongst themselves, and Jesus said, look, what's wrong with y'all, man? Y'all don't get this? I'm not talking about no bread. Go ahead.
How is it that ye do not understand that I spake it not to you concerning bread, that ye should beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees? Then understood they how that he bade them not beware of the leaven of bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees.
So he told them point blank, look, now they understood, hey, not to beware of the bread that they was giving out, but the doctrine that they were teaching you. That doctrine had leaven in it, and leaven represents sin. If somebody tells you you don't have to keep the law, they teaching you the leaven. That doctrine has leaven in it. That's bad doctrine. They teaching you to break God's commandments. If somebody tell you Christmas is okay, Easter's cool, it's for the kids, don't worry about it. There's leavening in that doctrine. You have to understand this, brothers and sisters. Jesus is not playing. These times are getting harder and harder. That's why these sodomites are coming out the woodworks and in your face. At any given time, you can walk down the street, see two women holding hands, see two men kissing. It wasn't like that back in the day, but it's like that now because why? All this leaven doctrine ain't going against it. They're going right along with it. And if the Sunday preachers go along with it, that discredits the book. And everybody looks at Sunday because Sunday's the biggest thing around. So if you have no foothold on this book and this is where your moral values are, you are out of pocket with the world. Something wrong with you. But that's another lesson too. Go to Acts 12. 17, read it, I'm sorry. 2 Peter. 2 Peter 1.
2.
I'm all over the place.
2 Peter 2.
2 Peter 2, yeah. I need some new glasses. 2 Peter 2. And pick it up at verse 1. 2 Peter 2 and 1. Read it.
But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you.
That's right. Go ahead.
Who privately shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of.
Ain't that what it is today? The way of truth is spoken of as being evil. And who's giving it to you? These false prophets. The ones that are dealing with that leaven doctrine. And many gonna follow their ways. Go ahead.
And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. For if God spared not the angels that sin, but cast them down to hell, and delivered them into chains of darkness, to be reserved unto judgment, and spared not the
old... Okay, that's good on that. I just wanted verse 3. 1 through 3. That's a typo. Let's go to Acts 12. So if somebody's giving you leavened doctrine, as opposed to the unleavened bread of life, you better find out what you're going to eat. Because something that's poison is going to kill you. And bad doctrine will kill you spiritually, which is the worst death you can have, is a spiritual death. And it's also called spiritual drunkenness. Physical drunkenness, you can wake up from that. Drink a whole lot of water. You're pretty good in a couple hours, right? But spiritual drunkenness, ain't no recovering from that. You can go to AA all you want. You ain't recovering from this spiritual drunkenness. Acts 12 and verse 1. Let's look at Paul. 12 and 1, read it.
Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church. And he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread.
So they're keeping unleavened bread. And this is after Jesus had died, resurrected, and went on back to heaven. So apparently Peter and them didn't get the memo that you don't have to keep these days no more. Or maybe they were keeping them because Jesus never changed anything. So those were the days of unleavened bread. So they were still keeping these high days. Peter, James, all the disciples. Acts 20. Flip over to Acts 20. And let's look at Paul, see what he was doing. Acts 20 and verse 1. Okay, read it.
And after the uproar was ceased, Paul called unto him the disciples and embraced them and departed for to go into Macedonia.
So now Paul, he got his disciples. Now they're getting ready to go to Macedonia. Go ahead.
And when he had gone over those parts, and had given them much exhortation, he came into Greece.
So now he's in Greece. Go ahead.
And there abode 3 months. And when the Jews laid wait for him, as he was about to sail into Syria, he purposed to return through Macedonia. And there accompanied him into Asia, Sopater of Berea, and of the Thessalonians, Aristarchus.
Thought you was going to get away, didn't you? Go ahead.
Aristarchus. And Secundus, and Gaius of Derbe, and Timotheus, and of Asia, Tychicus, and Trophimus. These going before tarried for us at Troas. And we sailed away from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread, and came unto them to Troas in 5 days, where we abode 7 days.
So now where was Paul at when he was keeping unleavened bread? He wasn't in Jerusalem. So wherever he was, he kept the high days, because the books say in all your dwellings. So wherever you happen to find yourself, observe these days. We observing them here in America, right? I'm quite sure you got some Israelites over there in Haiti, Jamaica, wherever the Lord scattered Israel, which is all over the place. Somebody got some understanding and they're keeping these days. Skip down to verse 13 and read it.
And we went before to ship and sailed unto Assos, there intending to take in Paul, for so had he appointed, minding himself to go afoot. And when he met with us at Assos, we took him in and came to Mytilene. And we sailed thence and came the next day over against Chios. And the next day we arrived at Samos and tarried at Trogallium. And the next day we came to Miletus. For Paul had determined to sail by Ephesus, because he would not spend the time in Asia. For he hasted, if it were possible for him to be at Jerusalem the day of Pentecost.
So now Paul was trying to get back to Jerusalem for what? The day of Pentecost, another high day which is coming up, which we will observe. So we see Paul is still keeping not only the days of unleavened bread, but Pentecost and all the rest of the high days as well. So how can Paul tell you, or you attribute him telling you that you don't have to keep it, and he keeping them himself? That don't sound right. Why would I tell you not to do something, but I'm going to do it, but I'm doing it? Why should I believe you? But if you don't have no understanding, then you'll be talking like that. That this person said, I don't have to do this. Let's go to Deuteronomy 16. Deuteronomy 16. Deuteronomy 16 and 16, read it.
Three times in a year shall all thy males appear before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose, in the feast of unleavened bread, and in the feast of weeks, and in the feast of tabernacles, and they shall not appear before the Lord empty.
So three times a year shall all thy males, and we got other scriptures to show you, bring your families to, we're going to read that. Shall all the males appear before the Lord thy God in the place where he shall choose, in the feast of unleavened bread, which we're keeping now, also in the feast of weeks, which is called Pentecost, we're going to keep that too, and in the feast of tabernacles, and they shall not appear before the Lord empty. So you can't come in here with nothing. We pull these feasts off ourselves. Everybody contributes. So don't come through the door broke and hungry. If you have nothing to contribute food-wise, put some money in the box. Because these feasts come up every year, and we pull these off ourselves. Verse 17, go ahead.
Every man shall give as he is able.
So everybody gives as they're able. Some of us don't have a lot. You can't give a lot if you don't have a lot. But if you got a lot, then you give a lot. Go ahead.
According to the blessing of the Lord thy God, which he hath given thee.
So you give according to the blessing, because this is all for the Lord. Let's go to Ezra chapter 6. And I have three more places. Ezra, the sixth chapter. So now Israel is back in the land, the children of the captivity, they back in there trying to build a temple. And let's see what they was doing. Even though they had been in captivity, they didn't lose sight on what they were supposed to do and how to serve the Lord. Ezra chapter 6, and pick it up at verse 16. Okay, read.
And the children of Israel, the priests and the Levites, and the rest of the children of the captivity kept the dedication of this house of God with joy, and offered at the dedication of this house of God 100 bullocks, 200 rams, 400 lambs, and for a sin offering for all Israel, 12 he-goats, according to the number of the tribes of Israel. And they set the priests in their divisions, and the Levites in their courses, for the service of God, which is at Jerusalem, as it is written in the book of Moses. And the children of Israel and the children of the captivity kept the Passover upon the 14th day of the first month.
So now the temple's completed, they're dedicating it, and now they are doing it when? On the Passover. They kept the Passover on the 14th day of the first month. Go ahead.
For the priests and the Levites were purified together. All of them were pure, and killed the Passover for all the children of the captivity, and for their brethren the priests, and for themselves. And the children of Israel, which were come again out of the captivity, and all such as had separated themselves unto them from the filthiness of the heathen of the land to seek the Lord God of Israel, did eat.
And that's what they were doing, and that's what we're doing. We are separating ourselves from the filthiness of this world. And we're trying to do this thing the right way to serve the Lord, the best that we know how. But look around you. Look outside. It's business as usual for them. They could care less about this. They ask anybody, you know what today is? No. Wednesday? Okay. He was like, you mean you didn't know that, brother? Yeah, I know it's Wednesday, but it's more than that. But go ahead. So they kept the Passover, and they did eat. Go ahead.
And kept the Feast of Unleavened Bread 7 days with joy.
And they kept the Feast of Unleavened Bread as well. For 7 days with what? With joy. This is a joyous occasion. I take pleasure in this stuff. We delight in these things. Go ahead.
For the Lord had made them joyful and turned the heart of the king of Assyria unto them to strengthen their hands in the work of the house of God, the God of Israel.
So while Israel was doing a good thing for the Lord and was joyfulness, he even turned the king of Assyria. And Assyria was doing Israel in for a long time. Took out the 10 tribes, tried to take out Hezekiah. And all of a sudden, the Lord then turned the king of Assyria's heart to do what? Help them out. Because I got a footnote next to it. Proverbs 16:7 says, when a man's ways please the Lord, even his enemies would be at rest. Assyria was not an ally to Israel. They were an enemy. But the Lord turned his heart to do what? Help them in the work of the house of God. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 5. So this is a joyous occasion right here. For those of us that are, you know, experience it for the first time. Praise the Lord. Now you can go back and tell whoever you're going to talk to that, you know, your son ain't crazy. Your daughter ain't crazy. Everything she's doing, we reading right out this book. And you can't go wrong with that. Traditions will kill you. But reading this book and doing, I mean, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with this? Just reading the book and doing it. But nowadays, people think you're crazy. But we got to keep eating this unleavened bread. Not only just because we're doing it physically for 7 days, you got to continue to eat it. Once this feast is over with, because now it turns spiritual. It's that unleavened bread of life. Jesus is that bread of life. You have to eat his word. Because once you put yourself under that blood, you better stay up under it. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 6, read it.
Your glorying is not good. Know ye not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump?
So a little sin will mess you up. It'll mess up a righteous person. Go to Ezekiel 18, and it'll tell you when a righteous man turns from his righteousness and starts committing iniquity and dies in his iniquity, it's a wrap for him. All that righteousness, the Lord don't remember. You can be righteous for 35 years and all of a sudden stop, skip all that. I don't want to do this no more. I'm going to go get me a pork chop. And you could die. Choke on that pork chop sandwich, eating it. That 35 years of righteousness is gone out the window. All the Lord see is that you died while you was committing iniquity. And he going to wake you up, and that's what you're going to be judged on. You turn from the Lord. Keep reading.
Purge out, therefore, the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as you are unleavened. For even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
So you got to purge out all that old sin so you could be a new lump. Because once you purge out the leaven, now you become unleavened. You purge that sin out, now you become righteous. Go ahead.
Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness.
So let's keep the feast, not with all that old leaven, not with all the old sin, because malice is evil. You can't come in here and you crazy and try to keep this feast. The Lord ain't going to have it. So we're going to keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but what?
But with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth.
But with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Deuteronomy 16. And we're going to start at verse 1. Okay, read.
Observe the month of Abib and keep the Passover unto the Lord thy God. For in the month of Abib, the Lord thy God brought thee forth out of Egypt by night. Thou shalt therefore sacrifice the Passover unto the Lord thy God of the flock and the herd, in the place which the Lord shall choose to place his name there. Thou shalt eat no leavened bread with it. 7 days shalt thou eat unleavened bread therewith, even the bread of affliction. For thou camest forth out of the land of Egypt in haste, that thou mayest remember the day when thou camest forth out of the land of Egypt all the days of thy life. And there shall be no leavened bread seen with thee in all thy coasts 7 days. Neither shall there anything of the flesh which thou sacrificest the first day at even remain all night until the morning.
So there shall be no leavened bread seen with thee. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. 7 days. Eat that unleavened bread for 7 days. And once you're done with that 7 days of physical unleavened bread, continue to eat that unleavened bread spiritually. Stay in this book. Because you done already put yourself under the blood by taking the Passover and being baptized, taking the Passover on the physical sense, but being baptized in the spiritual sense, putting yourself under the blood. So you got to continue to eat the unleavened bread of life for the rest of your life. Keep reading. Skip down to verse 8.
6 days thou shalt eat unleavened bread, and on the seventh day shall be a solemn assembly to the Lord thy God. Thou shalt do no work therein.
Verse 11.
And thou shalt rejoice before the Lord thy God, thou and thy son and thy daughter and thy manservant and thy maidservant and the Levite that is within thy gates, and the stranger and the fatherless and the widow that are among you, in the place which the Lord thy God hath chosen to place his name there.
So when we keep these feasts, we're going to rejoice. Your son, your daughter, manservant, maidservant, Levite, even the stranger. This is for everybody. This feast is for everybody. There shouldn't be no cars going out that road right now. Everybody should be shut down observing this feast somewhere. Go ahead.
And thou shalt remember that thou wast a bondman in Egypt, and thou shalt observe and do these statutes.
So this feast lets us know that we used to be. Our forefathers were slaves in Egypt. But we don't know that. All we know is what? Emancipation Proclamation. What is that? Our slavery goes beyond just the shores of America. Our slavery is right here in this book. And we still in captivity. Keep reading. We finished that?
Yep.
Okay, let's go to the last place, Deuteronomy 14, because we have to read this. Because the Lord told us to rejoice. And the Lord lets you know how to rejoice. And he's going to let you know right here, because this is a joyous occasion. And remember, we are doing this for the Lord. Deuteronomy 14, and start at verse 22. Read it.
Thou shalt truly tithe all the increase of thy seed, that the field bringeth forth year by year.
Now, this is the yearly tithe, because we always, you know, the Lord say don't be empty-handed when you come in here. So this is a yearly tithe. Go ahead.
And thou shalt eat before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose to place his name there, the tithe of thy corn, of thy wine, and of thine oil, and the firstlings of thy herds and of thy flocks, that thou mayest learn to fear the Lord thy God always.
So they tithing corn, wine, and oil, and the firstlings of thy herds. That was the things that they were doing. They had livestock. They were farmers. So whatever they had, they brought forth the first fruits of it, and they was going to the feast with it to offer it to the Lord. Go ahead.
And if the way be too long for thee, so that thou art not able to carry it, or if the place be too far from thee, which the Lord thy God shall choose to set his name there, when the Lord thy God has blessed thee.
So the Lord said, if the way is too long for you, where you can't carry those, push those herds all that way, or if the corn and the wine is too heavy for you, that you can't walk that far, what did he tell you to do? Go ahead.
Then shalt thou turn it into money, and bind up the money in thine hand, and shall go unto the place which the Lord thy God shall choose.
So you take what you have that you're going to the feast with, you can't make it, you sell it. You get you some money, and you go to the feast, and you have you a good time. You rejoice before the Lord. And how are you going to rejoice? Go ahead.
And thou shalt bestow that money for whatsoever thy soul lusted after.
So you buy whatever you want at the feast. Go ahead.
For oxen.
You want some oxtails.
Or for sheep.
Some lamb chops.
Or for wine.
Wine is what? Barefoot Merlot, Chardonnay, whatever y'all drink. And what else?
Or for strong drink.
And strong drink too. And y'all know me. That's Patron Silver. Strong drink. And do what?
Or for whatsoever thy soul desireth. And thou shalt eat there before the Lord thy God, and thou shalt rejoice, thou and thine household.
So we're going to eat and drink before the Lord our God, and we're going to rejoice, thou and thine household. And I hope you got some understanding in Jesus' name.
You don't need this, right?
Is the choir singing? Because I know everybody was, all right. So y'all, I guess they need time to set up. But while they setting up, I'll make a couple of announcements. The sign-up sheet for the seventh day of the feast is on the kitchen door. And that will take place Tuesday at 1 o'clock, same time, as always. So, where's my lighting guy? You gonna fix these lights, man? How many songs y'all doing?
One song.